Good morning. It's so good to be back at Living Water. You know, when I travel from Arizona to California, it's like I don't leave. I got a home there, but I got a home here as well. And I love you guys. When Rob called me a few weeks ago and asked if I would be willing to come to your church this morning and share, I asked him what you guys would be learning, what he'd be sharing. And he said that he was starting a new series, which he did last week, called The Light in the Dark. Let me bring this up just a little bit. Thank you. The War Among Us. And I immediately agreed. And then just as quickly inserted, since I'll only be there for a week, I'll take the light, and you, son, can stay in the dark as long as you need. The reason I was so quick to say yes was actually twofold. One was the opportunity to get out of the oven, affectionately known as Arizona. And you might wonder, how do we get by week after week, 110 to 115 degrees? And our answer is, yeah, but it's really a dry heat. Now, if you don't get that concept, go home today, turn your oven on to 115, open the door, lean in, and notice how dry the air is as your face begins to brown. The second and far more important reason I said yes was because the Holy Spirit had been speaking to me for several months on the idea of letting our light shine, found in Matthew 5. Specifically, I had been focused on the word let, which we will be studying this morning. To help us get on track, let me share this very short video. Okay, be honest, and I could kind of see from here, how many of you were singing along with the kids? Harry Dixon Lowes is credited with writing This Little Light of Mine in 1920. A century later, we're still teaching our children this catchy little tune. But is it biblical? Let's explore this together. If you have your Bibles, please turn with me to Matthew chapter 5, beginning in verse 14. You are the light of the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden, neither do people light a lamp and put it under a basket. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, that they may see your good deeds and glorify your Father in heaven. Last week, Pastor Rob preached from John chapter 8. And we learned that John's gospel contains seven instances where Christ declares, I am, followed by a clarifying object. Every one of the I ams is eternal. That is, it is true and it never ends. The first of these was, I am the bread of life. Spiritually speaking, when we dine on Christ's bread, we will never, ever hunger again. The second of the seven I ams was the key verse in Pastor Rob's sermon, verse 12 of John chapter 8, which says, when Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. Assured spiritually that we will never hunger again, Jesus makes his followers an immediate second promise. We will never walk in darkness again. Jesus took on the darkness of our sins, faced down death on the cross, that you and I would never again walk in darkness. And please don't miss the word never. Say never. Never. The Greek word for never in this verse is actually a combination of two short words, may and you. May means no, not, certainly not, by no means, absolutely not. And you means no, not, not at all, in no way. While you may think of the word never as the negative form of ever, it is actually a very positive word, and used here in John 12, we are reminded that we will never again walk in darkness. Now perhaps someone here this morning is struggling with the idea that you can lose your salvation after Christ has redeemed you. May I say, in Christian love, you cannot lose your salvation. I say this on the basis of Romans 4:8, which says, blessed is the man whose sin the Lord will never count against him. Literally, we could render this verse, Romans 4:8, this way. Blessed is the man whose sin the Lord will never, ever, absolutely not, in no way, not now, not ever, count against him. I say confidently that you cannot lose your salvation on the basis of God's promise. When God says never, he means never. That's true in the Hebrew, it's true in the Greek, and it's absolutely true in the English. If you are struggling with God's forgiveness, may I suggest memorizing Romans 4:8. And there is one other verse I would recommend to you to commit to memory. Philippians 1:6. Being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a good work in you will be faithful to complete it. Since you are an interactive church here, let me ask, what do you think when you hear the word faithful?
Loyalty.
Commitment. Say again.
Commitment.
Commitment. Honesty. Say it again.
Diligence.
Steadfast.
Follow through.
Thank you, Interactive Church. When I think of faithful, I think of the idea Royce gave us, keeping your word, doing what you say you will do. God is faithful and always keeps his word. Amen? There are no false starts with God. What he begins, he completes. No exceptions. He will never fail at being faithful. Personally, I try and avoid the use of the phrase, I will never. Because I know how easy it is to fail. Too often my never becomes, well, just this once. The promise of John 8:12 isn't my promise, which I might break. It is Christ, and he never breaks a promise. Amen? His promise to each of us is that we will never again walk in darkness. Sure, when we get our eyes off of Jesus, we may stub our toe now and then. But his promise is that when we trust him to direct ourselves steps, we will never again walk in darkness. Not now, not ever. Why? Because Jesus Christ is the light of the world. His light cannot be extinguished. He is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. He who brought light into the world is the light of the world. Jesus is the light that shines into the darkness. Anything that is not light needs light to illumine it, to define it, or to expose it. But light is light. Darkness is simply the absence of light. In other words, light does not need light to illumine it. Jesus is the light. And as such, he does not need us or anything else to illumine him. Jesus often remarked that he did not need the affirmation of men to define or confirm him. He was not being arrogant. He was simply saying, I am the light of the world. I don't need your secondary light to define or illumine me. In this, he is not saying that our light is not important. It is, and we'll be looking at that in just a moment. But for now, the important truth is that Jesus does not need anything or anyone to add to his light. Okay, Tom, I have no problem agreeing that Jesus is the light of the world. But he was sinless. And I'm just a frail human that does sometimes stub my toe, and occasionally I outright fail. Well, admitting that is a good start. And may I say, I agree with you. Each of us are humans that fail. And that's why I agree with Kara every Sunday morning when she says, there are no perfect people here. But too easily, we can use this as an excuse to remain on the sidelines. And we can wind up saying something along the lines of, I hope the coach doesn't call my number. I'm okay here on the bench. No bruises, no bumps, no broken bones. But that's not what God intends. We have been commanded to go and make a difference in our world, introducing people to Jesus and then discipling those who choose to follow him. And that begs the question, why don't we do this? And that begs another question, how do we do this? I believe we find the answer to both questions in the Sermon on the Mount. Candidly, I always flinch when I come to the Sermon on the Mount, which begins in Matthew 5 and continues through chapter 6 and through chapter 7. These three chapters are like a bright light that exposes everything hidden. You may be surprised to learn I've never killed anyone. No, I'm serious, not a single person. Check that one off the list. But then Christ shines his light on my heart and asks, yeah, Tom, but did you ever hate anyone? Well, not this morning. Not yet. Of course, I have to admit that I have hated. And not just anyone singular, but many, plural. Well then, Tom, you have committed murder. Yikes. I'll spare you the whole argument about lust and its corollary, committing adultery. While the Sermon on the Mount is an exhaustive heart check, it is also filled with blessings and promises. For example, here in Matthew 5, Christ defines us as the light of the world. What an honor. Wait. Earlier we said that Christ is the light of the world. Now he says that we are the light of the world? That may seem confusing or even contradictory, so let's examine this. Please turn in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 1, beginning in verse 14. And God said, let there be lights in the expanse of the sky to separate the day from the night. And let them serve as signs to mark the seasons and the days and the years. And let them be lights in the expanse of the sky to give light on the earth. And it was so. God made two great lights, the greater light to govern the day and the lesser light to govern the night. He also made the stars. On the fourth day of creation, God makes two lights, a greater light for the day and a lesser light for the night. Oh, and almost as an afterthought, The writer of Genesis adds, like it's no big deal, he also made the stars. The current best guess for the number of stars in our universe is 200 billion trillion. That's 200 followed by 24 zeros. Now, I have no idea if that number is accurate, but whatever the actual number is, there is something I find even more incredible. He calls them each by name. Isaiah 40:26 confirms this. Lift your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these? He who brings out the starry host one by one and calls them each by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. As an amateur astronomer with an emphasis on the word amateur, I love to walk outside just after sunset and watch the stars start popping into the sky one by one. In a short while, the sky is populated by a number of stars. Sirius, the brightest star in the heavens, and Rigel and Betelgeuse, that two of the stars that form the Hunter in the constellation Orion. Each star named by God appears in its appointed place in the sky. What's mind-blowing to me is that God didn't need these stars. They are there just to remind you and me of his glory. My interest in astronomy is intimately tied to two scriptures, both found in the Psalms. Psalm 19, verses 1 and 2, which says, "The heavens proclaim the glory of God. The skies display his craftsmanship. Day after day they continue to speak. Night after night they make him known." The vastness of the night sky speaks to God's greatness. The stars are not random. They are carefully positioned by God. And I marvel that the very same stars that I see when I look through my naked eye or through my binoculars or through one of my three telescopes are the very same stars that Adam and Moses and Abraham looked at over 4,000 years ago. The other scripture that I think of is Psalm 8, verses 3 and 4, which says, "When I look at the night sky and see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you set in place, what are mere mortals that you should think about them, human beings that you should care for them?" Pretty humbling when you think about it. If you ever find yourself thinking a little more highly than you ought, take a walk out, look into the night sky, and consider Psalm chapter 8. What are we mortals that you would think of us? I think that'll help set your feet back on the ground. So there, on that fourth day of creation, God creates two significant lights, the sun and the moon. But Houston, we have a problem. Unlike the sun, and for that matter, all of the stars, the moon doesn't have any light. Well, none of its own. It's a dark, cratered sphere that through a telescope looks like the face of a 15-year-old with acne. With no light of its own, it's entirely lighted by the reflective light of the sun. And just like the moon, with its dependence on the sun, when we are declared by Jesus to be light of the world, we do not need to create or manufacture light. We simply rely on his reflective light to illumine us. That's right. We are the reflective light of him who is the greater light. Accordingly, since both have the same source, Jesus, thank you, worship team, today getting our focus on Jesus, he can rightly declare that both he and each of us together are the light of the world. Are you following me? It is critical to the key point I want to make this morning the idea of letting rather than making our light shine. Just as the children sang, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. As I said earlier, this idea of letting our light shine has been on my heart for some time. What I mean is I've seen a number of Christians, some of them very good friends of mine, working so hard to be and act Christian. It's not hard to spot them. They generally look tired and worn out. They've simply expended energy trying to create or manufacture something that already exists. Existing light, trying to create light. Let me illustrate. I think you'll agree the room is pretty well lit this morning, correct? And by the way, a quick shout out to those who prepare the room each Sunday. We really appreciate what you do. Amen? But I think I'm going to enhance the light a little bit this morning. I brought my own lamp with me. There, how's that now? That better? Okay. Oh, I know what you're thinking. That's not that much. Okay, I got a brighter setting. How's that? Now we can see, right? Especially you in the back. This really helped, right? Okay. My silly illustration actually has a point. And that is, where light exists, we don't need to light the light. While it may seem silly, I've said it several times, and let me repeat it one more time. Light does not need light to illuminate. I know in my heart of hearts, I'm speaking to someone this morning. God has just laid that on my heart. I asked Rob permission to share this because it's just on my heart. Light does not need light to illuminate. Someone or some of you are trying too hard. And I don't think that's what Jesus wants. When I put on that light, of course it looks silly. And ultimately, what am I doing? I'm wearing down the battery needlessly. I hope that speaks to someone. After Jesus declares that we are the light of the world, he tells us the only thing that can stop that light from shining is if we hide or cover it. I loved Pastor Rob's illustration last week when he put on the headlamp. And the only time the lamp didn't shine is when he put his hand in front of the bulb. Now, if you were like me watching on YouTube, hey, all you YouTube followers, forgot to acknowledge you earlier. It was incredible because when the light caught the camera just right, Rob's face was totally illuminated. And the thing that impressed me and caught my attention was Rob didn't do anything to make that happen except move around. Every time we leave our homes to head out into the world, to work, to school, to the grocery store, to the golf course, to the soccer field, we emit light. That's right. It happens automatically without our having to do anything. Why? Because we are not creating the light. We are simply reflecting the light of Jesus, the light of the world. Our command is simple. Don't hide the light, the reflected light. In other words, don't create eclipses which hide the light. Now that you know that I'm an amateur astronomer, again I emphasize the word amateur, I love every eclipse we are able to see. As you are probably all aware, there's two types of eclipses. Solar eclipses, where the moon blocks the sun, and the lunar eclipses, where the earth blocks the sun from illuminating the moon. Just this past April, there was a total solar eclipse, which, if you were lucky enough to be in the right place, had a diamond ring effect. When the moon blocked the sun, it made it look like a diamond ring. Are you seeing this, McKenna? Our God is so amazing. He is able to take the gigantic sun and hide it behind a little moon. How is this possible? Amazingly, the distance of the moon from the earth is approximately 250,000 miles, and the distance from the earth to the sun is 93 million miles. As well, the diameter of the moon is 2,159 miles, and the diameter of the sun is 865,370 miles. Okay, take out your papers. The test will start. Now, I'll save you that. If you do the math, what you will find is that dividing the diameter of the moon by the diameter of the sun and dividing the distance of the moon from the earth to the distance of the sun from the earth, the number is exactly the same, 0.002. God positions the moon and the sun at exactly the right distance so something small can hide something much larger. Now, I've given a lot of numbers and what have you, and that's probably confusing, so let's illustrate it, will you? I have the earth here, and I have the sun. Royce, could I get a hand there? Now, Royce, walk back a little further, a little further, a little further. Perfect. Royce, the golf ball just hit the basketball perfectly. Did y'all see it? No, the problem was, unless you were in exactly the place where I am, you didn't see it. It's pretty amazing. Solar eclipses are amazing on many fronts. One is their pattern. Dating back to the Babylonian astronomer Ptolemy, it was determined that there are exactly 6,585 days or 18 years and 11 days between solar eclipses. This phenomenon, known as the Saros series, has been able to predict eclipses for thousands of years. So scientists and even amateur astronomers like me can predict eclipses hundreds of years in advance with remarkable accuracy. Our universe appears to be functioning in perfect, predictable order. How is it that the evolutionists and the science teachers in public schools, for that matter, teach us that the universe was formed by random particles banging into each other and holds together by chance, which is a direct contradiction of Colossians 1:17, which declares that Jesus is before all and in him all things hold together. Predictable eclipses seem to suggest a universe created with intelligent design by an intelligent designer. Sounds just like the Creator God we read about in Genesis 1. For those old enough to remember, it was not my intent to present an episode of Watch Mr. Wizard. But I felt it was worth our time to help remind us that we are the light of the world and we should not block that light. In other words, don't hide the light. Stop being an eclipse. Actually, we are likened to a city on a hill. Wherever we are found, there is light. I believe this goes hand in hand with Jesus' command to go, found in Matthew 28, verses 19 and 20. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. Did you catch it? The last sentence. I promise you, says Jesus, I will never not be the light within you. I will always be shining through you. Just be willing to go. What stops or at the very least hinders us from shining our lights. While Scripture teaches that we cannot extinguish the light, we can hide our lights under a basket. And what is the word that is prominently displayed on the side of that basket? The word fear, usually written in capital letters. Fear of what? Fear of rejection. Fear of what people might say about us. The fear of being misunderstood. Or even the fear that someone might ask us a Bible question that we can't answer. And caught in the fear dilemma, like moths, we head for the light in places where we are comfortable and safe, never risking. Without realizing it, we cover our light by turning away, avoiding encounters with the darkness. Christian fellowship is wonderful. Indeed, Hebrews 10 reminds us that we are commanded not to forgive or forget the assembling of ourselves as a community, just as we are doing here this morning. But while we are not, while we are to meet and love and encourage one another, if that's all we do, then we wind up only sharing light with others who have light. No, along the way, we must risk it and step into the darkness, trusting Jesus to light our way. Even when we are in step amid the darkness, he promises to help us if we'll dare to step outside our comfort zones and let him shine through us. Another example of letting rather than making is one that's important to me, the golf swing. Anyone who has played golf at all knows the harder we try to swing, the worser the result. That's right, I said worser. Somehow, we have to learn to let the club head generate the speed necessary, allowing physics to move the club head through the ball, like a rock tied to a piece of string. If you want to see this at its best, watch Lewis, or Brandon, or Cooper, or Connor. These young guys are amazing. They have all learned to let the club head move through the ball instead of trying to generate momentum on their own. And man, they all hit the ball a ton. There's one last nugget I'd like to extract from our text this morning. Jesus promises that if we will not hide our light, not only will we shine like the city on a hill, but we will give light to everyone in the house. That should be a great encouragement. Our houses, our homes, our castles are where we live much of our lives. But castles can be dark. I'll use myself as an example. Every time Pastor Rob gives his testimony and reminds you of how difficult it was seeing his dad, me, acting stupid under the influence of alcohol, I sit there watching in Arizona, ashamed as I relive my life before Christ. It blesses me to hear my son say that the change he saw in me was what motivated him to seek Christ at 12 years old. What a blessing. But to communicate how significant that change was, he has to share the man I was before Christ. And that part still hurts. I've actually begged God to remove it from my memory. But like the thorn in Paul's side, God has not eliminated the memory, but has used it to humble me and remind me how far he has brought me from that former life. I want to end by sharing something personal. After God saved me, maybe about a year or two, I got into an argument with God. And I questioned, why, God, if you knew you were going to save me anyway, why did you wait until my children were already grown? I would have raised them differently. I would have acted differently. Now I have to live with the guilt and the shame the rest of my life. I'd love to tell you that God put his arm around me and said, "It's okay, son." But that would be a lie. Actually, I didn't get any response from God. Not that I heard, anyway. But along the way, God proved his faithfulness. Say faithfulness. He heard my anguish. He saw my concern. And he knew my regret. Questioning God may seem foolish, but not when you read the Psalms of David. He brought all his troubles and his concerns to God, and he did it boldly. I think God is just fine hearing our concerns. In fact, I think he delights when we are honest before his throne. And trust me, he can handle it all. Amen? A short time after my questioning God, there was a big change in our home. My wife, who up to that time had never worked outside our home, agreed to watch a baby boy named Danny. And he was about 6 months old. Danny was in our house Monday through Friday, 8 to 5. And like Francis, my wife, over the months, I fell in love with little Danny. This arrangement continued for several years, and then, surprise, Danny got a sister, Vanessa, named after my very own daughter, Vanessa. Vanessa came into our home from the time she was about 2 months old. While my children were now in their teens and spending more time with their friends and less time with mom and dad, I didn't care. I had Danny and Vanessa to play with. They were such good kids. I don't ever remember having to raise my voice with either of them. Well, there was this one time. It was about 5:30, as I recall, and their mom was going to be there shortly to pick them up. I absently told them to please pick up their toys while I was intently watching a hockey game on the television. The forward from the team I was cheering for loaded up his stick, ready to take the slap shot, and I yelled out, "No!" You should have seen little Danny and Vanessa, convinced I was yelling at them about their toys. Understand, I had never yelled at them, either one. I never had reason to. I got down on the floor and drew both of them to me and spent the next 5 minutes apologizing. As Danny and Vanessa grew older and my wife started working outside the home, they remained a very big part of our home, even taking vacations with us. When Danny was around 12 and Vanessa was 10, their parents agreed to let my wife and I adopt them as our godchildren so we could become their godparents. Some of you may be thinking, godparents, isn't that a mafia thing? Well, no, not for us anyway. In fact, let me share the vows we made. Declaration of godparents. We, Tom and Frances Lane, declare before God our pledge to be faithful and loving godparents for Danny and Vanessa Harmon. As godparents, we vow to make a lifetime commitment to remain involved in Danny and Vanessa's lives, to be available to Danny and Vanessa at all times for counsel, encouragement, and companionship, and to maintain a lively interest in Danny and Vanessa's Christian education, faith, and life, and to pray consistently and often for Danny and Vanessa, and to remain devoted as mentors, helpers, and friends to Danny and Vanessa for the rest of our lives. We enter into this obligation willingly and with all sincerity and love. November 27th, 1998. My wife kept that pledge, just as she promised she would, right up to her final day on earth, October 10th, 2021. She loved Danny and Vanessa greatly. And I reaffirm those vows before God and each of you this morning. For any of you that don't know, my beautiful and loving goddaughter is one of your own, Vanessa Harmon Cross. To avoid confusion, since we already had a Vanessa in our home, we have always called Vanessa Lil Ness, or simply Ness. Now, I was hoping to have Ness stand up, but unfortunately, she's at home this morning recovering from COVID. Ness, I love you. Danny and Ness have stayed in our lives right up to this day. I talk to Danny regularly. I'm very proud of him. He's a U.S. Marshal, and he always has interesting stories to share. And since my wife has passed, little Ness has been an angel, a true gift from God. She calls me every week without fail, and we talk about everything under the sun, generally for an hour or two. She never calls to ask me for anything. She just calls to talk and make sure I'm okay. What a precious gift she is to me. Why do I share this? Because I hope by sharing you can see how faithful God was, knowing I could not turn the clock back and redo those years as a parent before I came to Christ. God did not leave me in my shame and regret. Rather, he decided to use our home to light up the lives of two small children. He gave me a do-over. While alcohol had been a major issue in my life, as Pastor Rob has shared, Ness and her brother have never seen me take a drink. I quit drinking in 1984, shortly after I was saved, 3 years before Ness was born. I haven't had a drink in 40 years, and honestly, I don't want one. God makes us a promise that he will restore the years that the locust devoured. In other words, while parts of our lives may have been wrecked, he can still restore and make things right. Rob says it, I'm going to repeat it. I'm speaking to someone this morning, someone who's made mistakes, just as I did. God wants to restore you, and he wants to take away the years that the locusts ate. My life, my children, my grandchildren's lives, and my godchildren's lives are all evidence of that truth. That I can stand before you this morning, loved by so many who are dear to me, is more than I could have hoped. On the basis of my restored life, I say that you can trust God and you can take him at his word. Worship team, if you want to come up now. We are, as declared by his word, the light of the world, just as he is the light of the world. We have the mind of Christ and we have the light of Christ. That's his promise. We shine in the city and we shine in the house. In so doing, we glorify God, our Father in heaven. So no matter your age, 8, 18, or 80, no matter your disappointments, no matter your failures and your false starts, on the basis of God's word that he is the light of the world living in you, there is no reason on earth why you can't sing like a little child. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let me close in a word of prayer. I just want to say in candor, this was hard. No one in their right mind wants to share the shame of their lives. And every time, as I shared with you, every time Rob shares that, it hurts afresh. But God is faithful, and he uses it to remind me. So when you hear maybe something that you've done wrong, and when you hear it, you're ashamed. No, God is faithful. Please know that. Let me close us in a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you so much, God. I thank you for your faithfulness. I thank you, God, that you are the one that restores what the locusts eat away. And I pray, oh God, for anyone here this morning that needs a fresh word from you, God, a fresh reminder of your faithfulness. I pray, oh God, even now in this moment, they would hear from you. And if there are any who need to hear from you, God, I pray that even they would be willing to meet with those who pray with others here at the end of our service. God, may you be blessed. As our scripture ended, God, we do all of this that you may be glorified. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. As I mentioned there, if there is any